a detective story. It's a game show.
It's got a game show element. It's got an educational element. And it's got, you know, the human element.
I suppose if the original proposer of the idea went to a producer and said, hey, I've got this great idea. We're going to get people to turn out their attics and their living rooms, and they're going to bring you things, and we're going to put them in front of the cameras, and we're going to have a great programme. And they just said, yeah, I mean, find another idea.
If you put all the experts together, you created probably the largest travelling encyclopedia. It's like a great travelling brain, and it goes from town to town.
We get to meet a vast, huge number of people of all sorts and kinds.
It's a bit like people and their pets in a way. And, you know, do they resemble the antiques that they bring along? Or is there something about them that makes them have this particular kind of antiques? And it's brilliant people watching.
There'll never be anything quite like it. And it is actually uniquely British.
It's become a British institution, a bit like HP Sauce and Arga cookers.
It's got some of the appeal of the National Lottery, frankly. People bring things to the tables in anticipation of them being very valuable, very interesting, very appealing in some way or another. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't.
The sheer excitement of it, you know, it's like winning the lottery, discovering a Titian or a Goya in your attic. Of course, it very rarely, if ever, happens, but there's always the possibility it might.
People love the sense of discovery, finding objects, and I suppose they would love to be able to say, well, we've got one of those on the dresser, or painting on the wall, or more worryingly, did my sister get that particular one in some family division 30 years ago?
I always say it's like Christmas every day because you never know what you're going to get.
So there's a sort of quaking feeling for the audience of millions of people throughout the world whenever an object is brought to the desk.
And it appeals to all the emotions, some of them noble, and then there's greed as well.
£5,000 to £6,000.
Between £8,000 and £12,000.
£40,000.
Good lord. £5,000 to £6,000.
Welcome to another sunny show. The forecast is better than this. However, we will have the normal arrangements where the show will move out to the tent, but the cameras will stay under here, and we'll carry on pretending it isn't raining if it does.
We're hoping to get the background on Dave with...
The Roadshow has come to Warwick Castle. It has been planned as an outdoor event, but the weather looks distinctly unpromising. With 25 years of experience, however, a little rain is no real problem. The production team and experts take it all in their stride. For many of the show's regulars, relaxing away from the world of art and antiques often means unexpected pastimes.
I've always been a supporting drummer. I'm just a rhythm drummer, just a swing drummer. I'm not a star or a technician, great technician. And I like to think that I can push a band or a little group or even a soloist rather than take over. So therefore it's unspectacular. But I think that's how I like to play. In fact, it's how I look at the interviews I do on the Roadshow, that the item and the interviewee are the stars. And I'm just there to coax them, to get the best out of them. I want the story from them. I can tell you quite quickly what something is. It's getting their story and looking at the object.
I got it off a dust cart.
A dust cart?
I did.
Well, then you've got to tell me the rest of the story.
Well, what happened is when I was first married, the old lady who was living next door to us asked my husband if he would help the dustman down with this old desk because she didn't think they would take it otherwise.
The thing that all the experts have in common is in enthusiasm for their subjects. They're all fanatical, obsessive about their subjects. When they see an object that interests them, they really are interested in it. It's not a performance.
very early 18th century oak table.
As early as that?
Oh, absolutely.
It was love at first sight for this little thing. I set that 1675 to 1680, and it's wonderful. I said, there's a pattern of turning on there that only lasted about 5 years. It had stood for most of its life in one place, because when we turned it upside down, it was dry and crisp and perfect. Perfect.
Absolutely fabulous. Peg sticking out again. It's a joy, great joy.
Exactly how the day it was made, and there were little cuts to show where the tenons were, which was a fault, really, and they'd never covered those up. So the last person to touch that was the man that made it. And that, I mean, it was worth £2,000 or £3,000, but that, to me, was the perfect piece of 17th century furniture.
I started with a volley, you end up with it. How did that work? Because
I'm in the... At Warwick Castle, things are going from bad to worse.
I don't think I've ever been on a bridge as grim as this, actually. We are talking grim. We're grim.
I'm standing in the rain.
OK, so...
Nice. Well,
watch the drip on my nose.
That's the sister painting.
Well, I suppose it serves us right. We come to an historic English setting and we get historic English weather. But it brings out the bulldog in us and we're all going to see it through, aren't we?
We'll see it through.
Yes. Yes.
John, I've got a slight problem on timing because we're having to go inside and do some furniture which isn't on the schedule. Because of the weather.
Unfortunately, the porcelain's still out here.
Should I just give this lady an umbrella?
Just to let you know, we're going to move into the marquee. We were going in the order in which you arrived, so just follow on.
My worst nightmare is...
gone missing.
Last I saw of Tim was in the castle, in the great hall.
Oh. How long ago?
About 10 minutes.
Apparently he was in the Great Hall about 10 minutes
worst
ago.
Worst nightmare is if it just downpours all day and everybody goes home and we're left with a lot of cameras and nothing to do.
This week, we're coming to you from the delightful surroundings of the Winnie Mandela Estate in the inner city crisis area of Lewisham. Well, there we are.
I think any parody is flattering in the end. There's probably not a major comedy programme that hasn't thought of doing a roadshow sketch. And some of them.
That the programme has become part of the sort of social fabric when it's referred to in quiz programmes or comedy programmes because there's a common language there.
For the silverwork alone on here at auction would fetch anything upwards of £15,000 or £16,000.
Would it really?
No, I'm just pulling your leg. Scrap.
A word for porcelain experts, please. We're moving you into the marquee. And I'm taking your cues down now for you.
At last. Oh, weather can only get better.
Put the umbrella up, John. Right. Stop moaning. No.
Here we go yet again. Hopefully into the dry.
Well, now, Mr. Bunny.
Yes.
Mr. Bunnykins.
Nothing about this one at all.
I'm going to go and ask. I wouldn't want to do anything other than what I do, which is to work with antiques. But I get away from, if you like, the limelight antiques, appearing, giving after dinner talks, etc. And I come down here, and it is just wonderful.
Very, very gentle.
There is the beautiful queen. We're very lucky because we've got, 20,000, 30,000 bees in here, and we found her. She's going along, she's putting eggs in all these little holes.
Do you have a bunny collection?
I do, but they're soft, not hard.
Okay.
I'm a terrible Mrs. Malaprop. I get teased dreadfully. I think it was ever since this naked male doll came out of a brown paper bag.
Yes, I have, yes.
If you know anything about old dolls, you couldn't tell whether they were male or female, but this one was definitely male.
Well, he's got everything. I'm not sure this is correct for a family show. Very unusual for a doll to have his genitive parts, is it called?
I mean, when we had our sort of get-together at the end of the year, all the roadshow people, I was presented with some frightful diploma saying,
for your genitive parts.
We're in Southwold today because it's a place that I like to go to in the summer. It's a fantastic release from London. Nothing between us and Holland here. And the smell of the sea, it's a magical release, really, from a real stress of being in the world of art and antiques, actually. I think a lot of people think it's something of a holiday of a job. In a way, it is. But nonetheless, there are pressures, and this certainly releases them. It's wonderful. It's a little message of love, actually. It's be sure of my love. It's fun, isn't it? And the diamonds are forever, the rubies are for passionate love, and the pearl is to do with Venus. You could expect to get £6,000 for that today. So it really was rather a good visit. Very good visit from my point of view.
Well, thank you very much. You've given me such a lot of information as well.
The stuff that dreams are made on in the Antiques Roadshow. I think the roadshow's real archaeology. There's no trowel, there's no tiny brush, but a shoebox is an archaeological site for me. I think possibly the most interesting and the rarest object that's turned up really very recently. It was a Saxon gold ring made of three twists of pure gold wire. Now, I think anybody looking at this ring would think it was sort of some kind of craft shop material, wouldn't they? Yeah. A sort of plated gold, albeit very rich yellow colour. And they might think that it was really a sort of almost cracker appeal, wouldn't they? And this has been unearthed actually in Norfolk by a fellow who was moving a hawthorn hedge. And suddenly, as the earth opened, there was this butter gleaming honey gold, absolutely incorruptible and exactly the same state as it was when a Saxon king or perhaps a Saxon nobleman had lost it. It slipped from his finger and fell into the ground, and then ding, it's gone. Imagine the swear words all in Anglo-Saxon. And then it lies there. For how many years? My goodness, is it 1,200 years? 1,000 years it lies in the ground. In 1,000 years, the ground can't touch this material. It's as buttery and wonderful today as it was for him or her when she lost it. Yeah. And it's a perfect souvenir of something very English and something extraordinarily rare. I find, actually, that this is probably the most exciting thing that I've ever found on the Antiques Roadshow. I think it's one of the most moving things that I've ever found. It was nothing to do with value then. It happened to be worth £10,000, but £10,000 has no relationship to what this thing is in the history of the United Kingdom, really. And that was a heart-stopping moment, I think, for me, and certainly for him too.
Of all the car collectors I've met over the years, they're always fascinated by watches and clocks. I think it must be some sort of generic disease, almost. We all have it. You'll find a man with a vintage car, he usually have a vintage wristwatch. I guess this year we're celebrating 25 years of the Antiques Roadshow, and I probably have the rather unfortunate honour, if you like, of being the one person who was on the very first pilot show at Hereford. And I've no doubt the BBC will drag out some pictures of me in kipper ties and broad-shouldered jackets.
In its original form, with the original lantern dial, it probably would have been worth something in the order of £1,000. Mm-hmm. Converted like this, £600 or £700.
Just like the town hall clock chiming, isn't it? Absolutely perfect. And that is, by any standards, one of the nicest, rarest bowls that we've ever seen, I think.
You said valuable, Arthur. How valuable, in fact?
Oh, that's worth a good deal of money. £3,500.
Part of the attraction was Arthur Negus, because Arthur had become a household name on Going for a Song. He was a remarkable man because he didn't start his television career till he was well over 60.
When I used to come home from school, my father would be in a workshop like you would.
He was the first person to really make antiques accessible and not just a snooty subject for a limited elitist audience.
The number of things, the endless flow of things that people bring, little tiny items of not much value and some a bit worth a bit more, and every now and then a real snorter crops up, all from ordinary folk who've just had these things about.
A gentleman came up to me with a marvellous little miniature long case clock, really only about 6 inches high, that he'd made out of 40 zillion matchsticks. So I passed it to Arthur, who was coming by the table, and unfortunately, he took it in his hand and it fell off, the top fell off. Nothing to do with him, it just fell in two halves. And we were both frightfully upset. But the man was absolutely made up. He said, "This is fantastic. I shall tell my grandchildren. Broken by Arthur Negus."
I got my first job working for Phillips Auctioneers. I had always been playing guitar and I had various bands that I'd been in over the years. I was starting to get serious and I started to play in some of the big London clubs like Dingwalls, and we even supported Georgie Fame at the Apollo Theatre of Victoria in front of quite a big crowd. And at this point, I had to sort of make a decision as whether I was going to stay in music and try and follow that or stay in the silver world. And I think in the end, what made the decision for me was that the people in the antiques world were generally much nicer than the people in the rock and roll world.
This is a very grand and imposing...
It's my very first time on camera.
No, actually, keep it.
And this very glamorous young lady came in with a low-cut T-shirt, wearing a great huge diamond and a cleavage, and she placed on the table this enormous Georgian-looking punch bowl.
Round this side, we have a nicely engraved coat of arms, which are contemporary with the date of this rim. So they've been put on, again, round about 1836, 37 maybe.
And during the course of conversation, it turned out that the bowl was in settlement of a debt. And the debt was around £30,000, which is what this bowl had been valued for.
We see it has the maker's mark of John Bridge. And you may notice that those marks were rubbed and rather polished out. And this is because, again, round the front here, all the way around the front, and on the other side as well, it's had an inscription which has been polished out. And in some places, the silver is so thin, you can actually push it in and out with your finger.
Very sadly for her, the bowl was a complete and utter fake. And all the hallmarks would have to have been erased to make it legal. And the thing was only worth about 3,000.
So what started off life as a much plainer bowl has been added to some years later and made into a much more elaborate looking bowl.
When she found out, she did her best to try and stop the BBC showing it, but Christopher, to his credit, stuck to his guns and it was shown.
The thing about the Roadshow is that it is a public event and everybody who comes gets the free valuation of their objects and they hopefully go away happy. And out of that we make a television programme, and how we do that is by skimming everything that comes in, and if an expert sees something that they think is interesting enough to make the programme, then they alert one of my team, the recording manager, Jeannie, and we then discuss whether it is worthy of the programme and whether we did one the same last week or whatever.
We could hold off this next item from furniture and actually go to the ventriloquist dummy if that helps, if we think it's going to clear... For the third item?
Yeah. We can't,
who knows?
We can't bring the furniture
out
yet.
All right.
Yeah, let's go that way.
OK, we're going with the ventriloquist.
Yes, I'll tell you.
I think that would make a good PSC. Yeah.
PSC. That's Roadshow Talk for Portable Single Camera. Each programme involves a panoply of technical equipment and personnel. In the course of 378 programmes over the past 25 years, 800,000 people have queued patiently with their treasured possessions, amounting to a staggering 7 million objects.
I do need to get you in, so come. No, you're coming in, both of you, please. The makeup lady's going to want to cut your hair. No, I'll take that.
Nice and short, Ian. Do you remember the conversation we had about that?
Yeah.
Just a few salient points, right?
Right, I understand. I have the message.
This was made sometime within the last 20 or 30 years. And it's very much...
Sorry, can we just stop there?
Yeah.
Whether we do the furniture or the book, we've got a problem with the weather. Should we go with a pagoda?
That was brought back to my mother from the Crimea. She had an uncle who went to the Crimea War, and he brought all that back.
Well, this is a nice story. Unfortunately, like so much family history, I have to disabuse you. It was not brought back from the Crimea. Crimea finished
Stopped on the way back, I don't know.
Well, the Crimea finished a long time before this was made. So it's not true, I'm afraid.
Sometimes they've been queuing for 4 or 5 hours, and it's worth maybe less than £10. And you know it's worth a lot to them. So my sort of, I vary it, but I usually say, well, it's worth more to you and your family because it was your great-grandmother's or whatever it is than it would be on the open market.
I try to let them down lightly. I say something like, well, I say, it's not worth much yet, dear. I say, put it away for 100 years and it will be. Off they go, quite happy, you know. Or I praise the bag they brought the stuff in. You know, I say, look after that. Look, off they go, looking after their Sainsbury's bag. It's going to be very valuable.
I think the further north you go, the more they can take it on the nose and they'll say, it's rubbish, isn't it? And you say, yes.
The arrivals queue is now within 15 minutes of being complete, so you'll have no one out here by way of public if we don't start moving people
right,
out.
Right, well, let's start moving back.
Because it's getting ever so stuffed in there anyway, difficult to work.
No, let's get it moving.
So who do you want back out first?
Well, let's get porcelain.
Porcelain,
yeah.
The porcelain queue! Isn't that marvellous how that works?
We're worried now.
The porcelain queue are being selected to go out into the sunshine. Your experts are already there, and we're going to take you back onto the grass. Thank you for your support.
I don't believe it.
Janet, if you make sure they all follow on, that will be wonderful.
Being an expert in porcelain is my job. I know a lot of people say, oh, you're so fortunate to do that, to do this. It is my job, and it's my day job. And when I come home, it's this. And I get annoyed about having to do an antique roadshow because it takes me away from this for a day, and a day is pretty valuable.
This is, I'm pretty sure this is a Georgia.
Those unforgiving close-ups of gardeners' dirty fingernails have been known to result in complaints.
Parts of dirty fingers were actually caused by newsprint, unwrapping things. But I don't know why it happens to mine more than anybody else's. But there are people, I believe, who garden in gloves, and I don't know how they do it. I tried all sorts of things to try and keep them clean, but I'm afraid that our correspondents just have to suffer in silence. I mean, there's nothing I can do about it, and I do try and scrub them.
Welcome to this, the first of the BBC's Antiques Roadshows.
The very first programme, somebody came along with two English Delft plates, Bristol Delft plates, dated 1707, and with the initials EB.
A very, very exciting thing. I mean, actually, to find a piece of English Delft, and in this case it's a Bristol piece, that's dated, is, you know, an event that happens once a year.
Well, I know it's been in the family for a number of generations.
And he said, my name is Richard Constable, and I descend from John Constable, the painter. Is it possible that the EB on this plate stands for East Berkhold, where John Constable lived? And I said, no, not at all. But unless I'm much mistaken, John Constable's wife's maiden name was Bicknell.
Well, I'll have to look up in the family tree to see if there's anything there.
He went home and he came back later in the afternoon and he said, yes, I had these Bicknell ancestors actually living in Bristol in early 1700s, and so it all fitted in nicely. Works of art are wonderful, but your superb mice and teapot is exactly the same tomorrow. Unless, of course, you drop it, which is another story. Whereas looking at this, in an hour's time, it'll be different.
Get up on the camera.
You know, I've got a lot of hobbies. I love dancing. I've always danced. I play real tennis 3 or 4 times a week. And I play early music, the viola da gamba. And I think if one didn't have things outside one's business and one's knowledge, you know, one would finish up being incredibly pious about one's beliefs and ideas about the business. The important thing is always discovering something new and finding out and gaining knowledge. And if one didn't have that rather possibly annoying curiosity, then we couldn't probably stay alive in this business. There was a wonderful occasion when a lady brought a suitcase in and she said she had some paintings.
And I suppose coming to Oldham and this particular part of the country, one must think, well, possibly a work by Ellis Lowry might turn up.
She brought the painting in on behalf of an elderly gentleman who used to be a driver to Lowry, and he'd been given this painting plus the other drawings, one of which had been on a cigarette packet, which he'd just discarded. He said, don't discard that, I'll pick that up, and so on. It's a small little drawing, but exquisite in its way. But the painting...
Does your friend have any idea of what he thinks it's worth?
No, no.
He's probably, he's a shy man, is he?
Oh, yes, very shy, well, yes.
I think it's probably worth £100,000.
Gosh. Oh. Oh.
She honestly couldn't breathe afterwards. I was quite worried for her for a moment. She just was shocked and gagging. And that worries you. I remember another occasion when John Bly told a lady that her furniture was very valuable, and she staggered. And John clutched her arm, and then she sat down, and I was standing watching this behind the cameras, and a man next to me said, that's my wife. She's not very well, you know. And I mean, it's never happened, but there, I guess, you have to be careful about these things.
I think I can say now, anyway, a minimum of 25,000. Grandfather's gold watch.
I don't believe it.
This throbbing little pink heart with diamonds is made by Carl Fabergé.
It is.
It jolly well is. Court jeweller to Nicholas and Alexandra, maker of the imperial Easter eggs, patronised by every single one of Queen Victoria's descendants. And I don't think there would be any chance of you acquiring this jewel under any other circumstances for less than £10,000 today.
I want my friend to come and,
and come and hug you. Yes, quite right.
It's that moment when you tell them what it's worth. That's the continuing success. And you can see in the eyes, you know, did they believe? Did they think, are they genuinely surprised? Or did they expect a lot more? Or are they desperate because they paid more than that for it? And that's the moment.
Everybody wants to know the value at the end, not just the people who bring the objects in, but most certainly the public. A journalist wrote that the Antiques Roadshow is the Price is Right with culture.
Seeing faces crumble, you know, and sort of like, oh, my God, you know, I mean, and they have to pretend, oh, well, I'm, you know, it's only worth sixpence, you know, or, you know, 50p, and they're not at all disappointed. Of course they're disappointed. Of course they're bitterly disappointed. They want someone to say it's worth £10 million.
The painting that you've brought along here today, signed down here, John Constable, 1813, really is absolutely nothing to do with John Constable.
How can you be absolutely sure without an X-ray?
Believe me, in the same way as if you get a letter from a member of your family, you don't have to read the signature at the bottom of the letter to know who it's by.
Copies invariably are all blurred and brown down there, aren't they?
No, I wouldn't say so. You see, copies are exceedingly clever. But anyway, I do appreciate you bringing it in, and I've enjoyed the lively discussion.
And you can't tell me who it is?
No, I can't tell you who it is, but I can tell you it's not a constable. If it was a constable, £3 million
plus.
Could
it be a Watt?
It would have... No, it's definitely not F.W. Watts.
Could it be a Paul?
You can, as it were, enjoy the discomfort of disappointed individuals, and you can share the enjoyment of other individuals when they suddenly realise that something really, really valuable has been discovered in their attic.
That the public want to measure the status of an object by its value, and frankly, that's a red herring. There is really no relationship between a work of art and its value. We have to say it as a sort of thermometer or barometer of our excitement, but it's slightly deceptive, really.
This is about people's lives. This is about our history. This is about these items that we're seeing on the programme actually shape who we are. They're part of us as the British nation, and I think that is the thing that's the strongest message. The little price tag at the end, at the end of things, that's not really that important. It's a nice little added extra.
I think some people have a great deal of difficulty with the idea that works of art and money are related. Museum people find it extremely difficult to talk about money in their works of art. But of course, the vast majority of works of art were made for money. They were made either on spec by an individual or by a manufacturer, or they were commissioned. You know, Michelangelo was painting for money. Now, of course, wonderful Sistine Chapel, but that's what it was all about.
£5,500?
Never.
£5,500 for one plate. And you've got the three of them.
We have four, actually.
Oh, four of Britannicas.
Four of these.
And 16 other similar.
Red Anchor.
Yes.
Is that a bit of a shock?
It's an absolute shock. It really
Having
is.
Having got up thinking we'd have a rather dull day, we've now had a splendid day.
And to make it worse for you, they're the sort of things which you should frankly put an insurance figure on of £6,000 to £6,500 each.
Each.
Well, that's your department.
Yes.
BBC Radio 4 News.
Right, and
now Brian has a problem in the
I come down here, put the radio on, and off I go. And it cleans my mind. It is like a, you know, it's a catharsis, really. 25 years I've been doing it. I was on the first programme.
Well, you've certainly, by the look of this, you've got some very good things.
But stories do accumulate. The one that I remember always, and I think a lot of people also remember, was a lady we saw in Hexham who came out with a Japanese blue and white plate. And I loved it. I thought it was a wonderful thing.
This one, probably about 1700. This is quite an early dish.
I've got five of those.
Wow.
Five.
Very unusual to have one.
Yes, real.
Your five. Set of five dishes, I think around £2,000 to £3,000 a set.
Goodness me.
Might even be a bit more.
Oh, dear.
This little one is honey. I think it's sweet.
Well, there are 10 of those.
Good heavens.
And five make a circle, more or less.
I mean, that's extraordinary, because I think one of those dishes would probably make £500 to £800. So we're talking £5,000 or so.
She produced another plate and the same thing happened. Oh, I've got 12 of those at home. And another plate and she got 18 of those at home.
There are 20 of these.
Good Lord, I don't believe it.
She had loads of the stuff. You could see his eyes were out on stalks. He could not believe this stash of rare Japanese porcelain.
Well, still more.
And then she brought out another one and another one, all these different kinds of plates, and each one was worth about £2,000.
These are magic.
I've got 10 of those, and each one is slightly different because, I mean, same design.
I don't believe
just,
this.
Yes, 10 of those.
We're talking £20,000 to £30,000 for the set. I tell you, this is one of the most exciting collections I've ever had.
Well, I'm so glad, but that means more to me than
it's,
the rest.
It's wiped me out for the rest of the day. Wonderful. Well, 25 years I've been doing that programme, and I've done more slots than anybody else on the programme, and still, I'm muddled up with Eric Knowles.
Bernie used to play one of these outside the Leicester Square Cinema on a Saturday night.
Bringing tears to people's eyes.
When people first begin to recognise you, they do recognise you, but they haven't got the slightest idea who you are. And I find that the public, we share a public with the cooking programmes and the gardening programmes. So art, cooking and antiques are really what the British love. So if you go to the Chelsea Flower Show, for instance, people will give you raking, searching glances, and sometimes they'll approach you and talk to you. And I remember walking down the aisle once and a fella came up to me and he said, God, he said, I don't know how to thank you. And I thought, well, that's quite strong, you know, really for the tiny part in the Antiques Roadshow. And he said, no, I'm feeling really very much better since the operation. And I clearly mistaken me for a surgeon that helped him out. And I didn't know quite what to say, except, well, I'm really so pleased that that's how you feel right now. And he said, look, I'll tell you what, it's dinner at my place next time. And I said, that'll be lovely, and walked on.
I think actually being recognised gives one a quite a sort of warm feeling. I think it's an odd phenomenon. I mean, I think it's ridiculous because you're on telly that, you know, you should have this sort of aura of wholly unjustified glamour.
I'm still able to go out and do my shopping on a Saturday without being mobbed, I have to say.
But you are genuinely with this. You're not just saying you're with this. You're with the company.
I am with the Antiques Roadshow.
You're introduced to somebody at a cocktail party and they say, oh, now I know your face, know your name. Now, where is it? Now, wait a minute, it wasn't at the Smiths, the drinks party, and you say no. Oh, well, were you at dinner with the... No, you weren't there. I know your face. Well, you might have seen it on television. Yes, absolutely, Antiques Roadshow. Absolutely, my favourite programme. Love it. If we ever go on holiday, always record it. Wonderful, watched it for 25 years. What do you do?
We've watched it so often. And to see some of the people that have been going for years and years and years on it, haven't they? I'm not very good at names and that sort of thing, but I recognise their faces.
Today's been really lovely, except for the weather, unfortunately. But I've really enjoyed it, and I've met some really lovely people while I've been queuing up.
I think the busiest show we've ever had was at Accrington when it was snowing, and 5,000 people queued in the snow and asleep and whatever.
But nowhere else in the world will people queue for 4 or 5 hours in an orderly fashion and be told that what they've brought along is of very little value and say thank you for a wonderful day.
The porcelain queue is on the move. You're doing a big S-bend up here.
I always thought the queues bring queues, actually.
So you're moving into here?
The people in England see a queue, there's something they must have some share in it. So the queues are enormously long sometimes, but it's exciting and it's very human, it's very eccentric, which is very English too, I think.
My first visit to a roadshow was when Samuel was only a few weeks old at Basingstoke, which was not the most exciting venue, but it was a very popular one. There were queues miles long on a blazing hot day. And I began to despair of ever reaching the top of the queue. So I thought, aha, Samuel could do with a feed. If I do some breastfeeding, perhaps we'll speed through the queue. But somebody from the roadshow came and asked me rather quietly and delicately, would I like to go inside to do this? And I didn't actually get anywhere in the queue at all because, I only just found my place in the queue again when we'd finished.
When the roadshow visited Canada, we arrived outside the National Gallery in Ottawa and there were two queues, not one. And we got to the front and we found that one queue was for the roadshow and the other queue was for Henry Sandon's autograph.
What did you do with that? There was a special queue, apparently, for me to give me kisses. And it was fantastic. You know, I had more kisses in Toronto on one day than I had in 45 years of marriage. And, I mean, it was absolutely marvellous, it really was.
You've still got about an hour ahead of you before you get to our reception.
We had a kilometre of people queuing. It's a bit worrying. And a man came to me and he said, we've been standing in the queue for 4 hours and my wife is not very well. She's not feeling very well. So I said, what we'll do is short-circuit the queue and we'll take the right expert to her. So I went to meet her and I said, and what have you got? And she said, well, I've got pain in my groin.
You want to go out? You want to get out?
Out, John!
You want to just get out?
Sometimes I think there's been a bit of argy-bargy and it hasn't been quite as disciplined as the British UK show. And in fact, what has absolutely amazed me is that the queuing in America, now I would have never thought, I think one of the reasons for the American roadshow not working was that they just wouldn't have stood in queue, but apparently they do. And that's quite an eye-opener.
Now you're 9:30. Go down there, science says 9:30. Just head towards it, okay?
We're rolling. Off it goes. This is moving fast. This moving fast, this queue. Our queues don't move this fast. They don't have to. Oh, who are these?
Great pups and
These are your great, great, great folks. They look as though they've been queuing for hours. Roll them, roll them, roll them. Did you bring this gentleman with you?
Yes, my antique.
How did, you're the antique?
I'm the antique.
After over 2 hours in the queuing hall, the guests finally make it into the main recording arena, and that long-awaited audience with an expert.
They sometimes call this a pumpkin finish on the top. Yeah, it's a lovely finish, in great shape.
This one's very nice, though, and the patriotic stuff is very popular right now. So you're looking at $8 to $10.
Where was the
ukulele? Trap art.
Trap art. Did you put a value on it? I would value it as a collector's piece between $800 and $1,200.
I'm thrilled to have seen that. Do you not know that the next time an Arkansas tramp ukulele comes in on a road show for me, I will be the only person in Western Europe to be able to identify it.
It was very, very popular for about 10 years, and then it just died away.
Now, so you've got 80 experts. They come from all over the place.
Yeah.
You don't pay them.
No.
Why not?
We can't afford to.
Well, they're real neat.
Why do they do it?
They get paid in pixels.
Yeah.
They do. They get to have their exposure to the 13 million people who watch our show.
These were made in about 1840 to 1860, and it's called a Ute first phase.
George Heppelwhite and Sheraton, their design books, had pieces like this.
Has it helped your business in any way, your own personal business?
I think it has, just because if I do go on a house visit, you know, to look at someone's
things.
Well, they don't do that, but you get some apple pie made for you, a cup of coffee already. You know, you're already, they feel as if they know you.
They do.
And that must happen to you in England, right? Look at that face. How can you resist that face? Come on, look at that.
So I, as an appraiser, have to come to you and say, I want to record this because it's good.
And you, why is it good? I want to know why.
Yep. Can we do this on camera?
Well, what is it? What is that?
Diamond.
I know. What's it worth? Is it worth $2? $100?
No, this one here probably is worth somewhere, maybe, value is not the thing.
Every place we go, in every city, every venue, we have 5,000 or 6,000 people. They're allowed to bring two items, let's say.
Yeah.
So we're seeing 10 or 12,000 items.
I thought it'd make an interesting piece.
What do you think? Does he have? What does he want to know?
He wants to know what they're worth.
What are the highlights that spring to mind?
There was an extraordinary Navajo blanket from about the 1840s that was very rare, one in wonderful condition, with an owner who really had no idea of what it was or that it could conceivably have that kind of value.
Are you a wealthy man, Ted?
No.
Well, sir, I'm still a little nervous here, I have to tell you. On a really bad day, this textile would be worth $350,000. On a good day, it's about $500,000.
Oh, my God.
And you had no idea.
I had no idea. I just laying on the back of a chair.
Well, sir, you have a national treasure.
Wow.
A national treasure.
Gee.
When you walked in with this, I just about died. Congratulations.
Gee.
Congratulations.
I can't believe this. Wow. Can't believe it.
Now, the gentleman standing right behind me has a frame. And in the frame, there is a fantastic Berlin porcelain plaque painted with a very pretty and naked young lady. Now, he's told me he doesn't know what it is, or at least what it's worth. And he's going to get an interesting surprise when he gets to his table.
Come on over here, please, sir.
I love something you do.
How you doing?
The surprise he gets, however, is not entirely to do with the value of his object.
Okay, what we'll do is we're going to call a producer over to get a look at these pieces and see if maybe we can get some taping done with these. Okay, are you into it? If they're interested in having these taped, would you do that?
Well, that's fine.
Okay, all right. She speaks for herself. She's really quite beautiful.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
Wow. I don't want to tell you too much about it.
You are the appraiser?
I will be the appraiser on this, yes. Yes.
The volunteer that's working here just pulled me aside and said the man who wants great plaque and this piece of Newcomb pottery is from here and was on the news 6 or 8 months ago, and he certainly had the piece of Newcomb College appraised, if not both pieces. So he's kind of pretending he doesn't know what they're worth.
Oh, it's an old game.
Yeah, it's an old game.
There are people who have come with the express agenda of getting on camera.
Yeah.
and they will affect not to know anything about this piece that they have very, very diligently researched.
Really?
Yeah, oh, yes, and so we have to look out for that.
Marsha now has to try to winkle out of this man just how much he knows or pretends not to know about
it. Okay. Exactly. But beyond that, even if he's found out, if that is the case, and he has found out, the reality still is it's a great piece. Yeah. And maybe for didactic purposes, it's worth exploring it on air.
Yeah, but we could have a tricky situation. Yeah. That's basically that's right. Okay. Well, it'll be interesting to see how Marsha deals with him.
Oh, she's tough. I think you're going to have some fun with this guy figuring out what he knows and what he doesn't know.
All right. Well, let me start with the guest and then we'll reconvene.
Okay.
Where is your guest?
He's sitting down right there waiting in his chair.
Hi, yes, I'm Marsha, one of the producers of the show.
Yes, Marsha. Carl Kleppinger.
Hi, Carl.
Nice to meet you.
So tell me, what did you bring? I didn't even see
these
it.
Two.
You
these
bought
two.
This?
Yes, ma'am.
And this. Okay, what's this? Do you know?
Pottery.
Yeah.
I think it is.
Yeah.
And this I don't know other than it's just porcelain.
Okay. What do you know about the Newcomb?
Well, I think my grandmother purchased it in Louisiana on a trip one time from Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was my mother subsidized it, then when she passed away, I...
Okay, have you had it appraised?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Tell me about this.
That I purchased from a mutual friend. She had prices on the items, so I liked that, and I paid her what she was asking for.
Which was what?
As I recall, it was
$125. $125. Now, do you know something about what it was made on? Did you buy it?
Oh, the reflection, no matter where you put the light, and then the fact it was porcelain.
Okay. Give me a minute. I want to talk with David, and I'll come back to you.
Okay. Fine.
No, it's not.
I just don't believe him.
It's a great visual. It's a
great
big,
visual. I'm not going to put him in the center.
It's a big. It's a lot of money for a piece of porcelain.
Oh,
you know never.
Yeah, it's not about the money. It's about the fact that he's lying to me, and I don't want to put somebody on TV who is lying to me, and I know he is. Yeah, I'm sorry to do it to you because I know it is. It's a
can
nice piece.
Can you do it
piece.
On the table though?
You should show it.
Show it, but you know what? I'm going to have a little conversation with him. Let me ask you something because there are no right or wrong answers here. The only right answer is, do you watch the show?
Oh, of course.
That's the only one that has to have the right answer to. Now, tell me, just because it's a small world here, there's... did you have this appraised on television before, the Newcomb Buzz? No right or wrong answers here except the truth.
Oh, I know. Ask the question again. I didn't...
Have you had the Buzz appraised on television before?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
No,
ma'am.
No. What do you do for work?
I'm retired now.
Retired? What did you used to do?
I was in banking.
Because there are some folks here, you know, we have a lot of media here, who say that you've had this appraised on television before.
Oh, no.
No. They confused you with someone.
I've never been on television at all in my life.
They've confused you with someone else.
Oh, they have to. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right. So you give me another minute. I'll be right back with you.
I'm not from here. So, I'm from
I don't
Texas.
Mean right. Yeah, but so how come you came to the show here in Hot Springs?
Well, my sister lives here.
All right. Well, give me another minute then.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to give this guy the benefit of the doubt. We're going to do an over the shoulder of the plaque.
Will it stand up?
It's very fragile here.
Okay, so you don't want to do
otherwise,
that.
Which worries right, me just fine. A little bit. Does that worry you? Okay. Hello, welcome to the Roadshow. You brought this plaque, and you bought it at an estate sale, is that right?
It was a private sale.
A private sale.
Uh-huh, in Kansas City, Missouri.
Well, it's German. It's made at the Royal Porcelain Factory in Berlin. It's beautiful painted. She is a beautiful, beautiful woman.
Uh-huh.
And quite frankly, you can't get any better. You cannot
really?
Get better. You have the best I've ever seen. I think you're looking at about $10,000 to $15,000 for it.
You're kidding. Oh my goodness. Oh.
Well, congratulations. Oh. What a buy.
Oh my gracious. But I paid the woman what she asked for.
Time you went back to work. You're
yeah.
Here.
Work. Nothing but work all the time. Work. Get on with it. There's a lot of people here.
Can I just pop in with this again for a moment? It's in fact Wedgwood, like I said, I thought it would be. What I deal with primarily is sort of Art Deco items. If someone comes of a a type of ceramic that perhaps is an earlier period that I'm used to dealing with. And I might pop it in front of Lodge or Henry Sandon just to sort of sometimes double check what my opinion is.
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, he ought to be called threadbare.
He ought to be called what?
Thread, as in threadbare.
Threadbare.
Being on a table with Bunny Campioni, if you allow yourself to earwig on what she's saying, then you pick up information for the next time, the next show yourself. So it's a learning process even for us experts.
The question most asked is not how much is it worth, but how do you know what it is?
This music box was made by a manufacturer called B.H. Abrahams.
How do you know that? Is it on there?
It's not. It's because that's what I'm here for.
Oh, yes.
Shut up. So this is the enzyme midget. Hello. It's upset the ducks, yeah? Which, hopefully, one will be able to find in a moment. Enzyme midget.
Can you just hold on to it a moment, boys? Well, thank you so much. We're just going to look up Mr. Simpson. He does seagulls. He's the seagull man.
Yeah. Do you know how much it's worth?
No idea. No idea at all. I'm the only one in the family that likes it.
That's super quality. That's really nice.
That little butterfly is the clue.
Yeah, it's a little tiny mark there. Hard to see. Yeah.
My goodness, what terrible condition.
It's rather like a doctor's surgery. Very important to give everybody your time. That's what they come for. That's what they want to see. And they want to hear you. And the thing is to talk through it.
Well, that's an interesting Bible. Now, is this a Quran?
Yes, it is. Yes.
It's a typical sort of Indian-style binding. And we start at this end. It's beautiful. A late 19th century Quran, but in absolutely stunning condition. What, £400 or £500? Mm-hmm. Qurans, even fine Qurans.
I say to anybody, go to Roadshow, just stand by the table and listen to the experts, to what they're saying about whatever item they're talking about, and it's fantastic.
This is the Audubon's Birds of America.
The first few times I went, it was nice to see myself in a crowd scene, but as being a groupie of the Roadshow, I was told that certain things I mustn't do, and one of the things is trying to avoid being on the camera.
My husband's grandmother found it in a barn at that time, and it was old and full of tools, and that's as much as we know.
We have gathered over the years a number of people who've become really attached to us. I remember a man in somewhere on the East Coast, it might have been Middlesbrough, who brought an enormous cake and stayed with us all day until we had all had a slice, which was not the most popular amongst the experts, it has to be said, but they did.
For the last 10 years, an annual children's edition called The Next Generation has been a Christmas treat for the Roadshow's 9 million viewers.
And have you collected every single one of these yourself?
What I saw on that day were hordes and hordes and hordes of young people who are totally passionate about their hobby.
The boyfriend, Ken, has just stand him up. There he is.
The experts were great with them. There was no patronising at all. Everybody was sort of treated equally. There was a real interest from both sides.
I got 12 clay pipes for £3.
So there's more than 12 here?
Yeah.
There was one little boy that I remember who collected some clay pipes. And they weren't particularly valuable, but there was a real story behind every single pipe that he'd collected, and he'd collected them himself.
There was these little notes of them.
It says, "This pipe was given to me by Canon Rutt from February 1951, dates from about the time of Queen Elizabeth."
I just think the dedication and the interest and the care and the attention that that young boy has paid to his collecting, he will be able to apply that to his life in so many other areas.
And I'm having great difficulty deciding who's who. So who are you?
Darren.
Dan?
Darren.
Darren and?
Declan.
You brought this along. I bet you don't know what it is.
Moustache cup.
Dead right. That's exactly what it was for. And have you got the saucer?
No, we don't have a saucer.
No saucer?
No.
Okay.
Get a saucer.
Be careful when you wash it, because you wash the gold off.
Yeah.
And it's worth about £15. You'll have to share that. £7.50 each.
I'm starting on three. I want some waffle from David because we're on the tower coming out to him.
Trevor, one, two, three. And if they're not in that order, they'll be different.
Oh, the Antiques Roadshow is fun. I mean, if it isn't fun, then we probably shouldn't be doing it.
Word perfect.
Yeah. Word perfect, yes. Well, one word was. The others were.
It's exciting and it's fun. And it's a sort of labour of love. Everybody on the show feels that. They enjoy being a member of the team that makes such a successful show and gives pleasure to many people.
And actually, there's a huge sort of camaraderie amongst the production team and the specialists. They're all going to a particular place that isn't their home, staying in a hotel the night before. There's a party before, and a great feeling of conviviality, and the experts are not shy people. They couldn't be shy people to do television. So there's lots of fun, there's lots of jokes.
Is this a Bloody Mary?
No.
A very large one.
It's a virgin.
An ordinary virgin.
I don't
believe it. With a bit of Worcestershire.
He's always been a bit of a virgin, David.
There is a sense of family about the Roadshow, and it's something that we try and encourage. And that, I believe, that spills onto the screen.
Sam really is a toy, yes. You can stroke him. He's quite a harmless. Quite harmless. Love it.
It's a tiny miniature potty, a little chamber pot.
I can't remember when I first started watching the Antiques Roadshow. I think it's just always been there.
Oh, dear. It's even fatter than me, this pot.
I can tell you it's made in Sweden because it says here, made in Sweden.
It's a fun programme. If antiques are not about fun, what is their point? You can't eat them, you can't drive anywhere in them, you can't wear them. They are for entertainment.
Well, I carried him on the bus, so...
You brought him in on the bus? I should get a taxi and take him back home, will you?
Such a cheeky Charlie, this hair terminal, and it's got this little button on it, which, if I may, I'm going to press and see what happens.
And his ears go
up. Oh, isn't that absolutely charming?
Who could have known when you started it at the BBC, 25 years later, this thing had become part of our culture? But it is.
You would have to insure the pair for at least £70,000 or £80,000 the pair.
Mm-hmm. Are you an agent?
Sick of life or tired of life? Why didn't
yes.
The tune of that is incredible.
We've all become antiques together, you know. Talk about, do a programme about us, really, you know, as antiques. They're much better than some of the items we see. No, that's only kidding.